We'll begin. Hello, everyone. So I'm Dr. Nitish Dogra. I'm a faculty at the International Institute of Health Management Research here in New Delhi. And my area of work pertains to disaster management and the environmental determinants of health. We are very fortunate that we have with us here three of my faculty colleagues, and they will be talking to you about different aspects of the pandemic. But before that, I just like to let you know about the International Institute of Health Management Research. This is a premier health institution that was set up in 2008 in New Delhi, and it is involved in education, research, and research capacity building and consulting in relation to health, with a very strong emphasis on the management sciences. So you can read more about it at our website, and you can get all the details about what we do. So so for today's session, I will begin by requesting our first speaker, Dr. Sutapa, to talk about the dimension of the pandemic, which pertains to the health system in general. Dr. Sutapa is an MD in community medicine. She has extensive experience in health systems going back to almost 20 years, and she is specialized in the area of mother and child. So over to you, Dr. Sudhakar.
Thank you, Dr. Nitish, and good afternoon, everybody, and welcome to this webinar on the strengths and challenges and opportunities, basically, of the health professionals in this current pandemic. So I'll just take a minute to share the screen with you, because I have some points jotted down in the form of a PPT. Is it visible to all? Are you all able to see the slide?
Yes, yes, Dr. Sutapa.
Okay, thank you. So I'll just begin with a figure which is not very unfamiliar to you nowadays. The thing is that this is a very common finding from most of the countries where we are seeing an increasing number of cases all over. Although the intensity and the impact of the pandemic, obviously it varies from country to country. Now, in India, what we do is that we are particularly worried about our own health status because of this emerging pandemic. And the reasons are there in plenty. First of all, we do not have enough hospital beds, as we all know. India has 7 beds per 10,000 population, which is much less as compared to what is recommended. The problem is even worse in the villages, because 70% of the healthcare infrastructure in India is limited to urban areas. The second and the third biggest problem is that we have too few doctors, and India does not even meet the minimum WHO standard of having one doctor per 1,000 population. And the main reason, which is all the more worrisome, is that India's health expenditure is quite low. So with this problem, what we felt was that whenever we talk about COVID or pandemic or corona, few thoughts keep coming to our mind, that okay, we do not have enough PPEs, we lack testing kits, we do not have enough ventilators to support our patients in case they land up in the ICU. There is no vaccine currently available, and there is no clear-cut direct therapy to treat the patients once they counter the disease. So in this scenario, when there are so many ifs and buts, there are some resources which actually came to our rescue, in the sense that we could mobilize our own resources in order to ensure that at least 2 lakh PP kits are supplied on a daily basis to every part of the country. Even Indian Railways also joined hands in order to ensure that there are PPEs made available to the medical personnel on a daily basis. Companies like Maruti Suzuki, they also jumped on to make ventilators and masks for these patients. And there are a few startup organizations, they also had contributed enough to make sure that we have made in India test kits, ventilators, and many more things made available. And of late, even PPKs were developed by Indian Navy. So these are just few indicators, a few examples to ensure that we could mobilize resources in the time of crisis. And what it clearly implies is that every great solution needs a great problem. And the problem here is of the pandemic. And the solutions are that we could actually mobilize the resources from different parts of our country. And whenever there are solutions, there are bound to be opportunities. And that is why we are talking about the newer opportunities which may come up in this course of the pandemic, maybe now or even later also. So we have divided the opportunities into three basic categories. One is about the public health setting, the opportunities which may emerge in the public health setting. One, the second is a research setting. Public health setting part will be covered by me. And the opportunities which are emerging in the field of research will be covered by Dr. Preetha. And those which are coming up in the corporate or the private sector will be covered by Dr. Nikita. The challenges which we face, all the healthcare professionals, is basically because we are always there in the forefront. And that is why it poses a lot of risk to the health of the medical and paramedical professionals, which is very much understood. Moreover, in many organizations, there has been a layover of staff. There have been salary cuts, promotions have been withheld, and moreover, we keep listening about assaults which are taking place on all categories of health professionals. The opportunities are that we need doctors and nurses everywhere. There have been advertisements in different parts of the country where they wanted doctors to volunteer to come and work for the COVID. And the roles of these doctors and nurses were for different categories of activities, which included screening, diagnosis, investigations, and research. Moreover, we have understood that we need district level managers in every district, especially for the pandemic preparedness. We do have district level managers everywhere, but they are meant for other activities. And as far as we understand, that they are not, sufficiently equipped and skilled to take care of pandemic should they arise. One example is that of Odisha, where they have prepared an excellent disaster management team. And the reason behind it is that they keep facing cyclones almost every 2 to 3 years. So it is the incidents which have actually made them highly sensitive to the demand of the health system and community in the face of such crisis. Once this acute phase gets over, there will be a topmost priority of the government to strengthen all the public health institutions to enhance their ability and skills of people to meet the public health needs. And this would be one opportunity which would be made open to all the young professionals who are now pursuing the career in public health. We all know that the government has already allocated ₹15,000 crore to boost the health infrastructure. Although this money goes for centralized procurement of essential medical equipment and drugs, but I'm sure that in the coming days, a lot more money would be allocated to recruit more people in the health sector because they are needed to manage those equipments as well. And in order to take care of the assault which is there on doctors and other professionals, the center has brought out an ordinance in which they have said that any crime which is made against any health professional, especially in this time of crisis, would be considered a non-bailable offense. So every case would be subjected to investigations which would be done within a period of 30 days. And it could fetch a fine of almost 50,000 to 2 lakhs penalty. And also it would ensure that the people who have committed this crime, they are imprisoned. So the period of imprisonment may vary from 3 months to 5 years. But in some cases, if the crime is grievous enough, then it can also be extended to almost 7 years in jail. So these are some hard measures taken by the government in order to protect the health of the health professionals who are now actively participating in this pandemic. Now, the other side of the story is about the NGOs, non-governmental organization. A lot of concerns have been raised because of the sustainability issue. And NGOs are largely supported by the CSR funds. And there were some projections made by somebody who said that around 200 million people could end up out of work by the time this pandemic ends. And there have been some estimates by the International Labour Organization which says that it is probably the most severe crisis after World War II. So which means that there are people who are actually feeling helpless in this kind of a situation. But then the World Economic Forum created an action form, which is basically to take care of these needs. So it's a global platform to convene the business community for collective action to protect people's livelihoods and facilitate business continuity and mobilize support for the COVID response. In fact, in our country also, NITI Aayog has written an email to almost 92,000 NGOs or civil society organizations which are registered on the Darpan portal of NITI Aayog. And there is a clear-cut appeal to them to assist the government, and the kind of support that they need from these NGOs are to identify the hotspots in their own locality, to deploy volunteers, to provide care to the elderly, to people who are suffering from disabilities and other vulnerable populations. And one more thing is that they have been entrusted with the responsibility of creating awareness in the community. So this is in nutshell about what I had to tell you about the emerging scope within the public health sector. So now I hand over to Nitish again. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Sadapa. Next, I'd like to request my colleague, Dr. Preeta. So Dr. Preeta, she is also a medical doctor, and she's done an MD in Community Health Administration. Most significantly, she was working with the United Nations at the time of H1N1 in 2009, coordinating for the UN. And she has over 10 years of experience in public health teaching and also disaster management. So over to you, Dr. Preeta.
Thank you, Dr. Nitish. Good afternoon to everyone. Welcome. Dr. Sutapa had clearly outlined the major challenges in public health. She also spoke about opportunities in systems development as well. So I would like to take off from where Dr. Sutapa left. I would be speaking about opportunities in epidemiology and public health research. You would all remember that when our Honorable Minister, Prime Minister Narendra Modi ji addressed us, he said, "Is virus ne bade bade rashtron ko bebas kar diya hai." That is what has happened. We are so proud of our human race. We think that human race is the ultimate race. Our brain, you know, human brain has immense possibilities. You know, the accomplishments which a human brain can do, nothing else can. But we have been literally brought to our knees by this single-stranded RNA virus, you know, an invisible microscopic virus. We have seen how major economies in the world are struggling to cope with it. But if we look around, we also see some refreshing stories, success stories. Some countries like South Korea, Taiwan, even in India, are the state of Kerala. They are somewhat, they have been better, or they have been more successful in dealing with this virus than other countries. What could be the reason? If you carefully look at them, you'll see that there's a common thread. They have dealt with a similar challenge in the past. So they were successful in learning from their challenges, you know, tackling their challenge, learning from them, and converting those challenges into opportunities. They, all of them, have experience in dealing with a similar threat in the past, be it Nipah virus, be it MERS, be it SARS. So they have used that the learnings from that those challenges in building their health systems so that they were better prepared for a future threat like COVID. We can also, you know, this is a perfect opportunity for us also to utilize the challenges which we have faced into learnings, convert them into a better world, better prepared world to face threats, pandemic threats, which may emerge during our lifetime and during the lives of future generations. You know, these terms, some of the terms that I am going to say have been, you know, the property of epidemiologists only or public health professionals only. Now they have become household names. You see a media discussion, you will see these three terms being thrown about. in you know, civilians, politicians, everyone use these terms very easily now. Hand hygiene, physical distancing, social distancing, asymptomatic cases is spreading the infection. Now everyone knows incubation period. When a case, you know, after 14 days of quarantine, someone develops symptoms, people say incubation period is not 14 days after all. People have started understanding these terms. Flattening of the curve, epidemic curve, you know, was the property of epidemiologists only. Today, everyone speaks about flattening the curve, quarantine, isolation, difference between both. Everything comes so easily to the general public and others. This is also the perfect opportunity to use the skills of epidemiologists, which the governments all over the world and in the country are increasingly recognizing. Now we have all the states of India wanting district epidemiologists for all the districts. Everyone has understood that skills of epidemiology are paramount for a health system, for a successful health system. There is an increasing demand for epidemiology related skills, like field epidemiology skills, like developing a surveillance system, carrying out surveillance, analyzing surveillance data, predicting epidemics, modeling and predicting future pandemics, etc. And it will increase in future. This also brings in a lot of the interest, the public interest, as well as the understanding by the governments. This is going to bring in a lot of teaching and training opportunities also for the epidemiologists. Lots of courses are going to be launched, formal and informal, online and residential. Lots of courses are going to come, in-service teaching, full-time university teaching, etc. So, you know, it's going to be an avalanche of opportunities. So WHO says the main need of research is in these areas, the underlined areas. We have to contain the spread of the epidemic. We also have to facilitate care for those who are affected. And we also have to utilize these learnings so that we are better prepared for the next unforeseen pandemic threats. Now, that brings in again two aspects. One is doing research, lots of opportunities. Of course, we need data very fast. We need data, we need timely data. But then research also has to bring in a lot of rigor. There are going to be lots of opportunities for experimental studies, simple descriptive studies, analytical studies, like case control studies, etc., which we usually say. But the rigor is also important. It's not going to be a one-time activity. It is going to be replicated across countries, across states, across communities. So what I'm trying to say is there are going to be plenty of opportunities for those professionals who are interested in public health research. So some of the examples are, we all know that there is a race for developing and launching a vaccine against COVID. And we know that many countries are in the process of developing an effective vaccine also. Now, launching a vaccine is not easy. Developing it is one thing, and then understanding the efficiency of the vaccine. Is it effective against the disease? Is it going to produce side effects? That is also important. So many vaccines, or the vaccine being developed by many countries, are in trial stage. We have different phases of trials. So phase 1, phase 2 trial stage, most of the vaccines are. In phase one trial, the new vaccine is tried on about 10 to 20 people, volunteers who have given informed consent. And in the second phase of trial, it is extended to a few hundreds. And in the third phase of the trial, it is extended to more people. The fourth trial, phase 4 of the trial, is after marketing of the vaccine. It's called post-marketing surveillance. So we have vaccines in trial stage. Now, when India is also in the process of developing a vaccine, so these trials would also need plenty of epidemiologists and public health professionals. So in India also, you know, I just picked out some examples of research studies which are COVID-related, which are going on in India. ICMR, as we all know, they were for some time, they have been trying to check if community transmission is happening. They have been doing surveillance of all respiratory cases who have been admitted in ICU and all. and then there are drug trials which are going on, plasma trials, where convalescent plasma or plasma of patients who have been cured of COVID is used to treat current patients. It is going on in many centers in the country. More centers have applied. ICMR is considering giving permission to them also. There is also an Ayush trial. 4 Ayurvedic formulas are being tested and undergoing trial if they are useful, effective against COVID. Now, speaking of research, it's not limited to health sector. Health sector cannot own COVID as such. You know, there are many other factors. Impact is also on multiple sectors. So solutions also lie there, not just in health sector. So it's a perfect opportunity to collaborate between sectors. A multi-sectoral approach, multi-sectoral research should be done with the intention or with the objective of bringing out solutions which are lasting, evidence-based and lasting. That's all from me. Thank you. Over to Dr. Nitish.
Dr. Nitish?
I think then you can start.
Hospital management expert with more.
I think we can't. He's not audible.
Yeah. So
You start.
Okay. So good afternoon, everyone. Okay, Dr. Nitish is here.
Sorry. I just wanted to finish my introduction. So Ms. Nikita is a hospital management expert with almost 20 years of experience. She's been working with several different corporate hospitals. She has an MHA, MBA, and MPhil from also an MPhil from Bates Pilani, and her main area of focus is quality. So over to you.
Thank you, Dr. Nitish. Thank you, Dr. Sutapa and Dr. Preeta, for a great insight on public health and what are the challenges and opportunities that we oversee. We are already loaded with